हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज़ डॉक्टर नीलू श्रीवास्तव, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन इंग्लिश, गवर्नमेंट दिग्विजय ऑटोनॉमस पीजी कॉलेज, राजनांदगांव. एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टेक अप एजी गार्डनर्स वन ऑफ द वेरी फेमस एसेज ऑन सेइंग प्लीज. एज वी नो स्टूडेंट्स, लिटरेचर इज़ द मिरर ऑफ सोसाइटी एंड द लाइफ ऑन अर्थ हैज़ प्लेंटी ऑफ इवेंट्स एंड सिचुएशंस, बट स्टिल ओनली अ फ्यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड द मॉरल बिहाइंड दोज इंसिडेंट्स. And A.G. Gardner was one of them whose essays are an eye-opener to realize the pitfalls in our everyday activities. He writes with the sociological and moralistic perspective with a tinge of humor in it. The added flavors of irony and satire lighten the hearts of the readers to encounter the real stupidity in their lives. His subjects mainly concern with the aspects like courage, greatness, forgiveness, ignorance, manners, habits, resolutions, etc. And the essay which we are going to study today is on saying please, which is a beautiful essay on the moral of good behavior. So let us start the essay, the text first. We will read the text first. We will go through the explanations and then a critical analysis, and thereafter important questions which are being asked on this essay. So let us start with the essay. So students, let us start the essay on saying please by A.G. Gardner. The essay on saying please basically deals with little but socially important incidents from our day-to-day life. It tells us about the great value of politeness and mannerism. The author points out that bad manners are antisocial. Though bad manners are not considered as crimes in the eyes of the law, the society always looked down upon the rude people. According to Gardner, good manners and bad manners are really contagious. If bad manners of one person influence others and make them rude and ill-tempered, good manners of one person also affect others and make them be polite and kind in turn. So let us start the essay, the text. The essay starts with the incident which A.G. Gardner is describing here. Once the young lift man in a city office who threw a passenger out of his lift the other morning and was fined for the offense was undoubtedly in the wrong. It was a question of please. The complainant entering the lift said top. The lift man demanded top please. And in this concession being refused, he not only declined to comply with the instruction but hurled the passenger out of the lift. This, of course, was carrying a comment on manner too far. Discourtesy is not a legal offense and it does not excuse assault and battery. If a burglar breaks into my house and I knock him down, the law will acquit me. And if I am physically assaulted, it will permit me to retaliate with reasonable violence. It does this because the burglar and my assailant have broken quite definite commands of the law. But no legal system could attempt to legislate against bad manners or could sanction the use of violence against something which it does not itself recognize as a legally punishable offense. And whatever our sympathy with the lift man, we must admit that the law is reasonable. So Gardner says that once a lift man was there in a city office and one of the passengers, he entered the lift and instead of saying please, he just said that top. That means that man wanted to go to the top floor. The lift man expected that man to say top please, and he could not bear that rude behavior of that man. And he just, you know, hit that man and threw him out of the lift. So he says that discourtesy is not a legal offense, but what the lift man did, was it really correct? Of course, the other man who said top only instead of top, please. He was also wrong, but the lift man also cannot use violence against a person who is not polite to him. He cannot use that rash behavior. So he says, Gardner says that there is no legal system who can attempt to legislate against bad manners, because no law can punish that man for not saying please. So that behavior of the lift man, we have sympathy with him, the lift man, but still his behavior cannot be called reasonably well. Then he says, it would never do if we were at liberty to box people's ears because we did not like their behavior or the tone of their voices or the scowl on their faces. Our fists would never be idle, and the gutters of the city would run with blood all day. He says that if all the people keep on punishing the people just for being rude to them, then our fist will always be working. They will never be idle, and the gutters of the city will always run with blood all day. It may be as uncivil as I may please, and the law will protect me against violent retaliation. I may be haughty or boorish, and there is no penalty to pay except the penalty of being written down an ill-mannered fellow. The maximum that can be done against a rude man is that he is an ill-mannered man. He doesn't know how to behave with the people. The law does not compel me to say please. No law compels me to say please or to attune my voice to other people's sensibilities at any more than it says that I shall not wax my mustache or dye my hair or wear ringlets down my back, because it is your choice. No one can force you to be humble, to be polite. It does not recognize the laceration of our feelings as a case for compensation. There is no allowance for moral and intellectual damages in these matters. This does not mean that the damages are negligible. He says that it doesn't mean that to be rude is permitted, because the damages which these people do, they are not negligible at all. It is probable that the lift man was much more acutely hurt by what he regarded as a slur upon his social standing than he would have been if he has a kick on the shins for which he could have got a legal redress. So he says that maybe that the lift man was expecting that man to be very polite. But if he is not polite, if he is rude, it doesn't allow that lift man to be violent. So that is the point which A.G. Gardner is actually emphasizing here. The pain of a kick on the shin soon passes away, but the pain of a wound to our self-respect or our vanity may poison a whole day. He says, if you get hurt by some wound or by a kick, then the pain of that may pass away with the passage of time. But if you have a wound to your self-respect or your vanity, then it doesn't heal up, easily. And if it happens in the morning, then the whole day is ruined, it spoils. I can imagine that lift man denied the relief of throwing the author of his wound out of the lift, brooding over the insult by the hour and visiting it on his wife in the evening as the only way of restoring his equilibrium. He says, Gardner, that I can imagine that lift man who had encountered such a bad behavior with a man, for the whole day he would have been upset, and in the evening when he would have reached his home, he must have transferred that frustration to his wife to keep his mental balance equal. For there are few things more catching than bad temper and bad manners. When Sir Anthony Absolute bullied Captain Absolute, the latter went out and bullied his man. Fag, whereupon Fag went out downstairs and kicked the page boy. Probably the man who said top to the lift man was really only getting back on his employer who had not said good morning to him. So actually all these ill behaviors, they get transferred from one person to another. That is what Gardner says. He says that it may be that the lift man to whom that man did not say top please, maybe one of his employers did not say good morning to him in the morning. And maybe the person who did not say good morning to him when he had come to office at home, his wife may have some quarrel with him at breakfast, to whom the cook had been insolent because the housemaid had answered her back. So all these things are actually interrelated, and these ill behaviors, they transfer from one person to another. So they are contagious. We infect the world with our ill humors. Bad manners probably do more to poison the stream of the general life than all the crimes in the calendar. For one wife who gets a black eye from an otherwise good-natured husband, there are 100 who live a life of martyrdom under the shadow of a morose temper. But all the same, the law cannot become the guardian of our private manners. He says that no law can regulate this good behavior. That means they cannot interfere in our private manners. No decalogue could cover the vast area of offenses, and no court could administer a law which governed our social civilities, our speech, the tilt of our eyebrows, and all our moods and manners. But though we are bound to endorse the verdict against the lift man, most people will have a certain sympathy with him. While it is true that there is no law that compels us to say please, there is a social practice much older and much more sacred than any law which enjoins us to be civil. He says that of course it is true that there is no law which can compel a person to be humble, to be polite, but also there is a social practice which is much older than these laws, and that actually instructs us to be civil. And the first requirement of civility is that we should acknowledge a service. Please and thank you are the small change with which we pay our way as social beings. They are the little courtesies by which we keep the machine of our life oiled and running sweetly. He says that these are the little courtesies that make our life very happy, very sweet, very lovable. They put our intercourse upon the basis of a friendly cooperation and easy give and take, instead of on the basis of superiors dictating to inferiors. It is a very vulgar mind that would wish to command where he can have the service for asking, and have it with willingness and good feeling instead of resentment. So he says that we should try to be as polite as we can. It is not therefore with any feeling of unfriendliness to conductors as a class that I pay a tribute to a particular member of that class. Now here A.G. Gardner gives a story of a bus conductor. He gives an anecdote of a bus conductor by which he was very much impressed. And he says, I pay a tribute to a particular member of that class. I first became conscious of his existence one day when I jumped onto a bus and found that I had left home without any money in my pocket. Everyone has had the experience and knows the feeling, the mixed feeling which the discovery arouses. So he says that once I just boarded the bus, and after boarding the bus, when the ticket collector came for the ticket, then I realized that I had left my wallet at home and my pocket was empty. And I had such an embarrassed situation I was in. Then you are annoyed because you look like a fool at the best and like a knave at the worst. And he says, you feel so much annoyed on yourself because you look like a fool before others. You would not be at all surprised if the conductor eyed you coldly, as much as to say, yes, I know that stale old tricks. And I thought that the conductor would say to me, yes, I know that old trick that you have forgotten your wallet at home, and this is nothing new. Now then you get off. And then he would have get me down from the bus. And even if the conductor is a good fellow and lets you down easily, you are faced with the necessity of going back and the inconvenience perhaps of missing your train or your engagement. Having searched my pockets in vain for stray coppers and having found it was utterly penniless, I told the conductor with as honest a face as I could assume that I could not pay the fare and I must go back to home for money. Then I really made my face as honest I could make, and then I told him that I am really very sorry, I cannot pay you the fare because I have forgotten my wallet at home. Oh, you need not get off. That's all right, said he. All right, said I. And I was really surprised to get the answer from the ticket collector. Oh, you need not get off. That's okay. It's all right. I was surprised. I said, all right. But I have not a copper on me. Oh, I'll book you through, he replied. Where do you want to go? He says, it's okay if you don't have any money. I'll book you a ticket. Where do you want to go? He handled his bundle of tickets with the air of a man who was prepared to give me a ticket for anywhere from the bank to Hong Kong. And he asked me as if he could take me anywhere in the world, although I didn't have even a single penny in my pocket. I said it was very kind of him and told him where I wanted to go. And as he gave me the ticket, I said, but where shall I send the fare? Oh, you'll see me someday, all right, he said cheerfully as he turned to go. He replied me very sweetly that, oh, you'll see me someday. You can return me anytime. There's no hurry. And then luckily my fingers still wandering in the corners of my pockets lighted on a shilling and the account was squared. And then suddenly my finger just got one of the shilling and I paid the amount of the ticket. But the fact did not lessen the glow of pleasure which so good natured an action had given me. But the fact that I got the penny in my pocket doesn't lessen, you know, the pleasure and the good natured behavior of that ticket collector. A few days later, my most sensitive toe was trampled on rather heavily as I sat reading on the top of a bus. I looked up with the same anger and more agony and saw my friend of the cheerful countenance. Oh, sorry, sir. And another day, I was again traveling in a bus and suddenly one of my toes was trampled with a heavy boot of a ticket collector and I was got very angry and painful also. And I saw, just looked up and then I saw the same person, my friend. Sorry, sir, he said, I know these are heavy boots, got them because my own feet had trod on so much and now I am treading on another people's. I hope I didn't hurt you, sir. He had hurt me, but he was so nice about it that I assured him he hadn't. After this, I began to observe him whenever I boarded his bus and found a curious pleasure in the constant good nature of his bearing. So that ticket collector was such a nice guy that, you know, I used to find that person whenever I boarded a bus. And I really wished that I could meet him again and again. Because he seemed to have an inexhaustible fund of patience and a gift for making his passengers comfortable, I noticed that if it was raining, he would run up the stairs to give someone the tip that there was room inside. With old people, he was as considerate as a son and with children as solicitous as a father. And he was such a lovable and considerate person that if there was some old man, he would really go and help him in crossing the road, and if there is any child, he would behave with him as a father. He had evidently a peculiarly warm place in his heart for the young people and always indulged in some merry zest with them. If he had a blind man on board, it was not enough to set him down safely on the pavement. He would call to Bill in front to wait while he took him across the road or round the corner or otherwise safely on his way. In short, I found that he irradiated such an atmosphere of good temper and kindliness that a journey with him was a lesson in natural courtesy and good manners. So a journey with him was, you know, a lesson to learn to really take inside in natural courtesy. What struck me particularly was the ease with which he got through his work. And he says that if bad manners are infectious, so also are good manners. If we encounter incivility, most of us are apt to become uncivil, but it is an unusually uncouched person who can be disagreeably with sunny people. So he says it is a matter of general agreement that the war has had a chilling effect upon those little everyday civilities of behavior that sweeten the general air. So A.G. Gardner says that I agree that just because of the world war which has just been finished, there is a chilling effect upon the behavior of the people. The people are not normal, they are not so sweet, so they are not so cordial with each other. We must get those civilities back if we are to make life kindly and tolerable for each other. We cannot get them back by invoking the law. The policeman is a necessary symbol and law is a necessary institution for a society that is still somewhat lower than the angels. But the law can only protect us against material attack. Again, he says that law can only protect us against any material attack on us, not against any bad behavior. Nor will the liftsman's way of meeting moral affront by physical violence help us to restore the civilities. Suggest to him that he would have had a more subtle and effective revenge if he had treated the gentleman who would not say please with elaborate politeness. He would have had the victory not only over the boor but over himself, and that is the victory that counts. The polite man may lose the material advantage, but he always has the spiritual victory. So Gardner ends the essay by saying that a polite man may not be very rich, may not be very affluent in his life, but he may not have material advantages in his life, but he always has spiritual victory over his own conscience, and which is a very important thing in the life of a man. So here the essay ends. So students, I hope you must have loved the essay written by A.G. Gardner. Let's have a critical analysis of this essay. In his essay on saying please, A.G. Gardner discusses legal regulations versus social norms. Although no one is legally mandated to be courteous and well-mannered, it is generally expected of society, or at least wished for, to act in a polite manner. He describes a situation in which a man physically assaulted another man for refusing to say please, and how although society may agree that the man was rude and perhaps many people would have been just as angry, this recourse was beyond necessary, unacceptable and illegal. Politeness, Gardner believes, makes social interactions run smoothly and positively, influences the perception that others have of a person, whereas rudeness invites negativity and more rudeness. The selected quote above, and whatever our sympathy with the lift man, we must admit that the law is reasonable. It would never do if we were at liberty to box other people's ears because we did not like their behavior, or the tone of their voices, or the scowl on their faces, makes the point that if people became physically aggressive every time they did not think someone else was being polite enough, then nothing except violence would ever occur. Everyone would be assaulting each other continuously. Therefore, people must learn to be as polite as possible and also to accept impoliteness when it occurs as a part of life. The narrator's example of the conductor is also interesting, as the conductor at all times appears to take the higher moral ground despite what he may think of his passengers on the road. He never judges anyone and is apologetic when he makes a mistake, something that is noticeable when he stands on the narrator's feet, though an accident, the conductor ensures that he apologizes and that no offense can be taken. This may be important as Gardner may be suggesting that just as the lift man lost his patience and peace of mind, the conductor on the other hand remains morally upright. So that should be learned from that bus conductor. He is sensible enough to know when he has made a mistake and when he must apologize. Unlike the lift man who has taken matters personally and as a result has broken the law, which takes precedence over any ill-mannered approach that one may receive from another person. Legality takes precedence over moral laws in the eyes of society, and one is left to deal with a perceived moral injustice by themselves without the support of the law. As to whether the reader agrees with this is a different matter, as loss of peace of mind over a moral slight can result in the law being broken or others who are innocent being affected. Gardner may also be exploring the difficulties that can be incurred by an individual when dealing with the public. The lift man acted inappropriately, while the conductor on the other hand is wise enough to know that it is better to be sweet to each passenger than to offend them. Not only does the conductor keep his peace of mind, but he also ensures that he is not responsible for breaking the law. Though the conductor may feel like doing so, in contrast, the lift man and the conductor are two different types of people. The lift man loses control because he feels slighted in some way, that he may be deemed by the man entering the lift as being inferior to him. While the conductor, on the other hand, does not lose control of his emotions. Rather, he continues to be polite, well-mannered and civil to all his passengers. It is by losing control that the lift man faces the more serious charge of breaking the law. Morally, the law is not responsible for how the lift man has been treated. The law only deals with issues of legal nature, and that is the problem. It is also clear to the reader that the happier of the two men is the conductor. The lift man, having lost control, acts irresponsibly, whereas if he takes the higher moral ground that is shown by the conductor, he still keeps his peace of mind and acts morally superior to the man who did not say please, which leaves the reader realizing that regardless of how one is morally treated by another person, one should never leave courtesy. So, as a conclusion, we can say that the theme of the essay revolves around the issues of manners, and while so students, in conclusion, we can say that the theme of the essay revolves around the issues of manners, and while we might be frustrated with the rudeness around us, individuals can counter it with demonstrating good manners to one another and brightening one another's day. If we are uncivil, others will also be uncivil, and if we show good manners, others will also behave well. A cheerful person can make the gloomiest person cheerful. It is a sound investment to possess good manners. If Wordsworth could get a lesson from a leech gatherer, there is no harm in getting a lesson from a person like a bus conductor who has good manners. Being polite towards others is like having a spiritual victory over ourselves. So I hope, students, you must have understood the essay thoroughly. Let us have a look on the questions which can be asked to you. Students, I have earlier talked about A.G. Gardner as an essayist. So one of the very important questions that can be asked is A.G. Gardner, discuss A.G. Gardner as an essayist and his writing style and his techniques. Another important question is a critical appreciation of the essay on saying please. Then there are some more minor questions which can be asked. They are, why do we call bad manners infections? Is there any law against the bad manners? Draw a character sketch of the polite conductor. Why should a person be civil? And how can good manners affect our social life? And what is the theme of this essay? So I am sure, student, that you will prepare the questions answers thoroughly, and we will meet in another essay with another essay on painted face soon in my next lecture. Till then, goodbye and thank you.